Okay, that's me. Hi, I'm Peter. I'm talking a little bit about inviting leadership and what is all about inviting leadership. What is the theory behind and why we need inviting leadership to get truly agile. First of all, a disclaimer, do not believe me a single word. I'm not here to convince you. Absolutely not. I'm absolutely happy if I am achieving my mission to plant a little seed of doubt in your thinking, in your theories, in your experiences you have, and my mission is actually accomplished if you actually try out what you hear tonight. That's all I want. There will be a lot of open construction sites left because I only have 20 minutes for something which is actually worth filling like 2 or 3 or 4 days. So I will provide some more follow-up information and links. You can sign up and leave your email address and I'll gonna send you these links and all the material in a few days from now on. You'll find that website if you go to bit.ly/HRS meetup in one word. So let's go. When we talk about agile, we should be aware that we are talking about grown-ups. Really grown-up individuals who should ideally form teams of which are self-organizing. So we are not talking about childish people, we are not talking about people who are kind of unripe or something like this, we are talking of grown-ups. This is what you have to have in your mind all the time when we talk about leadership, when we talk about transformation, when we talk about installing agile. So let's look at humans, at grown-ups. Just a short answer, just give me a sign with your hand. Have you heard of Douglas McGregor? Who has heard of Douglas McGregor? One, that's cool. So Douglas McGregor is a very interesting person. He used to be a professor at the MIT and he was into social technologies and social science. He came up with a hypothesis. He said, okay, let's have two theories. His theories were called theory X and theory Y. He said, we're in this experiment, in this thinking, we divide individuals into these two groups. You either can be X or Y. The X group are individuals who go to work because they have to work, because they have to pay the rent, they have to pay everything for their family, and who will avoid work if any possibility arises to do so. You have to motivate these people. They are not intrinsically motivated. You have to tell those people what to do and how to do. You have to control these people if they do what they have been said to do. You have to control the outcome. You have to control, are they really there for the work? And those people, they do not like to pick up responsibility, to take over responsibility, not at all. On the other hand, you have the Y type. The Y type, of course, they have to work as well for paying their rent, but it's not so much about that kind of have to go to work. They are like, hey, let's go to work because it's just fun. Actually, they are intrinsically motivated. They love to go to work. They say, hey, it's cool. I have great project ahead of mine. let's go for it. They are absolutely happy to take over responsibility. And the best you can do is tell them what problem is ahead, what needs to be done, and then get out of their way. Now, McGregor went to enterprises and he asked people in these enterprises if the conditions, the working conditions allow it, and if you have a deep look inside, and this is my question to you, have a deep look into your true nature. Are you more the X type or more the Y type? I don't want to have hand signs right now, but count on it, there should be something very wrong if there are not at least 95% telling me they are the Y type and not the X type. Now, McGregor went further and asked a second question. He asked the same people, okay, you're a Y type, now what about your colleagues? How many percent of your colleagues are the X type? And guess what? It was not a small number that people said, yeah, my colleagues, there are a lot of X types. You have to motivate them, you have to kick their asses, you have to tell them what to do and how to do it, and you have to control these people, otherwise nothing will happen, nothing. That's a contradiction, because he asked the same group in one enterprise. It cannot be that everybody is like, yeah, nature, my nature is Y, and on the other hand, if you ask the other people, people will tell you, yeah, there are a lot of X types. And this is because of the following. It's a perception problem. This is a technical problem. So that's a perception problem, because if you judge yourself, you do it by the intention you have. You do it by your deepest nature. So you look inside, what's your intention, what is your nature, and you'll say, yeah, I'm a Y type. So looking in the mirror, you do this based off intention. But if you have a look at others, guess what? Your judgment is not based on their intention, because usually you can't figure out their intention. You can't see their real nature. So actually, you do it on their action, how they behave. And how they behave, that is triggered by the system they are in. So if you're in an enterprise, if this enterprise is absolutely X-orientated and treats their people like they were X, controls them, tells them not only what's the problem, what is to do, but how to do it, actually when to do it and until when to do it, implies like, imposes like things like motivation. I really hate this motivation trainers and these people who teach you how to motivate other people. This is totally X. So if you're in that kind of enterprise, let's call it, it's a more or less Tayloristic enterprise, like about 95% and more of companies today, you should behave like an X, because it's actually dangerous to take over responsibility. It's actually the best you can do to listen to your leaders telling you what to do and how to do it, and then carry it out exactly in that way. Because if you don't, because if you behave like your nature, if you behave like an Y person, you'll get into trouble. The least that will happen, you won't get your promotion. Your career is over, it's stalling. The worst that will happen is you'll get fired. So this is that problem here, that the system you are in triggers your behavior, and your behavior, your action is what others think of you. So everybody thinks you're an X type as long as you're working in an X environment. Now I ask you, do we want X people, or at least people behaving like X, because there are no X people, we are all Y people. We don't want it and we do not need it, at least if we think agile. We need people to behave like Y. And that is the reason why we have to pay attention that our system is as well a Y system. We have to identify everything which is X behavior in leadership, in how a company is run, how the organization is designed. Identify everything which is X and kill it and stop it. Because the moment we imply X practices on people, people will behave like X. And it doesn't matter if they Y or X, they will behave like X. So, the leadership must fit the Y theory as well. And the best way, or the best, let's say theory I got to hold off is inviting leadership. There is a genius book by Daniel Matzik, and I will send you the link if you leave your email address on my homepage. Which is called Inviting Leadership, which goes way into this thing. And Inviting Leadership is a base social technology for a lot of things which build on top of this to support Y behavior in organizations. I want to give you one short example of where Inviting Leadership works out very good, which is when we think about transitions. For transitions, it's absolutely crucial that we do not have any X practices. So there goes the discussion. Top-down is not an option. Top-down is absolutely X behavior. Top-down decisions like change management will not trigger Y behavior, but X behavior. And we do not want to have X behavior. We do not need this. So there we are with the change management and the change. Now, is resistance to change a natural behavior of people? What do you think? Who thinks if we have change, there is always like resistance to it? usually. Who thinks that? Okay, who thinks change is just something natural in life? That's the point. I mean, life actually is pure change. Every minute is change. And everybody of us loves change. If it's not imposed. Impose a change onto other people and you will get the full resistance to it. And I tell you, it's very intelligent that there's resistance to it. And the more intelligent people are, the more resistance will be. So with transformations, it's never good to do change management, which is imposing change. It's never good to have a change team or something like this coming up or going behind some walls in some nice little session rooms thinking about how can we make the transformation in this organization, and then they come out with the plan and roll it out on everybody. Imposed change. A big problem. And you can go to university and study like 6 years of change management, which is actually how do I overcome the resistance, the intelligent resistance of people? How can I push and like force them into the change I want? And what you have is a very X technology of change management, which will trigger X behavior, which will not bring us anywhere if we want to have self-organized, self-managed teams. People who are intrinsically motivated, happy to pick up responsibility, no way. Not with change management, not with top-down. So how could we actually do it? And this is where inviting leadership is coming into place. And one example, one specific example of inviting leadership is, for example, if you do your transition, your transformation with something which is called open space technologies. Usually you know, or you might know, open space from meetups as a conference format. But I tell you, if you use open space that way, it's like drinking alcohol-free beer, the warm one. If you use open space technology for transition, that is like the following. First of all, you need a sponsor, which is top-level management, who speaks out an invitation. An invitation that defines what will be the transition about. There can be different kind of transition, like an agile transition, or like the transition of a whole company. Who says, this is something which is urgent and we do not have a solution for this problem. And we will invite everybody who wants to join us for an open space meeting and to find the best solutions together. That is a good invitation, that you have a theme, that you have no solution, that you need a solution right now, or better, yesterday, and that you tell the people what is on the plan next, what is on the agenda next, open space meeting. Now, an invitation, the nature of an invitation is that you can accept it or decline it. You have to be free to decline it without consequences. By this, guess who will be at the open space meeting? Only everybody who wants to work on the transformation, who says, yeah, agile, finally, let's do it. And the second thing, the people who say, oh, I have to go there because this agile stuff, this you know, it's like the 68 hippie thing in our modern times. I have to take care about this, that this won't happen. You'll have these people there as well. And now you go and do your open space, and with the open space you have a format which is highly positive if you have a controversial atmosphere and you have people who are like very motivated to work on it. May it be because they are in favor or they don't want to see it. And then in an open space meeting, that's the same as you know from conferences, is that the authority is given to everybody. Everybody is on the same level, and that's where inviting leadership reveals its power, because then the change is triggered by everyone. No resistance, best solutions which are supported by everyone, and thus you have the benefits or the basics to do a very fast organizational transformation. As I said, bit.ly/hrsmeetup in one word. Leave your email address, I'll send you more information, and I guess I have time for two questions and then I will be kicked off stage. Questions? The higher management feels threatened, is the question. No, it doesn't. They are not threatened by this. Everybody in the it's very crucial that the higher management is absolutely aware what the consequences of this way is. It's absolutely crucial that the higher management is supporting this. It's the worst thing that can happen is that you go for this approach, and of course with the first open space meeting it's not over. This has to be followed up by a transition time. Usually 90 days is a good time, and after the 90 days you have a second open space meeting to round the whole process up. Daniel Metzig also, who I already mentioned with the inviting leadership, he is also the guy who brought up some 5 or 6 years ago open space agility, which is just a transformation on that base to introduce agility into an organization totally on invitation-based methods. Then, if you have prepared the top management to that level, they are actually very happy and very keen on it, because it's the easiest thing for them to do a successful change in a very short time without the interruption of the usual normal business processes. There's no cut. One other question? Yeah, open space, there is a limit to it, which is the room where you host the open space. The world has seen open spaces up to 4,000 people. This is which I know of, the largest open space meeting. And of course, you have to get into tricky details there, but it's also possible to do it on that scale. You need to find your ways. There is not enough time yet here on stage to go into deep in that, but it's possible. Thank you very much. I'll be around, of course, after the other talks, and happy to say hello to Falco now for the next talk.